Not a natural teacher then, but Maurice was always happiest on the stage anyway. His reputation grew and grew throughout the 16 years he spent with the BBC Northern, and other orchestras started approaching him, particularly in London, where the LSO looked to have a principal job coming up. And that was, is, arguably the best trumpet seat in the world. Maurice headed south, and then to Mexico.
The first time I saw Maurice, he was wearing a sombrero. We were out sort of on the pyramids in Mexico, and I saw this man with a sombrero, and eventually it was Maurice. I think he was on trial there or something.
Double bass player Gerald Newsom is one of the LSO's longest-serving players, and he well remembers Maurice's arrival in 1977 and how he brought a new sound and approach to the orchestra's trumpet section.
Maurice had some very big steps to follow, because there was the enormous shadow there of a giant, another legend, which was Bill Lang, and Bill Lang was our principal trumpet there, and Bill had this great, terrific reputation, and he was a giant of a player, a wonderful player, also from the north of England, so obviously it's that quality of the brass band tradition came out there. And then we had Howard Snell came in as principal trumpet, he was there for a while, and then Maurice came, and he brought with him an enormous new life and energy, and almost a modernism. Bill Lang had a very warm sound, as I said, the touch of the vibrato is just very much that, almost sort of a slight, that northern brass band, sort of silver band concept. And Maurice came in a very clear, very precise, and I suppose some people would say slightly American sound, whatever that means.
I'd worked with the orchestra in Mexico the previous November, December, but I actually started on my first day on contract was at Denham Studios, and it was the first take was the opening credits, Star Wars, first Topsy. It was great.
John Williams, like Maurice, arrived at Denham Studios with a fine reputation and a huge amount of fame and success. But both men emerged from that first Star Wars session as global, well, should we say universal stars. For Maurice, that first note heralded the beginning of international stardom. The success of the film projected that extraordinary, diamond-sharp sound around the world, and he never looked back. John Williams, with the Star Wars score, was to re-establish the power of the symphony orchestra on soundtracks with what is still regarded as one of the greatest film scores ever written. And he attributes much of that success to Maurice.
Decades yet to come. I love the what we call here, I think of as the British school of brass playing. It's a different sound to the European brass, I think, and certainly from our American brass playing, all of which is wonderful in their particular ways. But I love the British approach and tradition and style. And Maurice led the way for me with those films. I mean, he was, again, the ideal voice of the hero for Superman, and he had the same effect on our audiences with Indiana Jones and Harry Potter and others, other things that we've done.